So this is Pragmatic Unit Testing in C and C++. I'm Matt Hargett. There we go. So a little about me, because I'm utterly pretentious. I've been programming since about 1985. I started programming on a computer called a TI-99-4A in BASIC with my mom. My mom's a programmer. We used to type in programs from program listing magazines like Compute Magazine and Byte Magazine and stuff like that. All the first video games that I played on computers were games that I typed in. I've been a long-time contributor to open source. I first started using Linux in 1994 for an internet service provider that I worked at in Springfield, Illinois, and big open source proponents. Like Windows too, just because I like one doesn't mean I have to hate the other. For the purposes of this talk, I've done a lot of, I used to do computer security stuff. I did a lot of talks at conferences around the world on computer security and static analysis and finding vulnerabilities. But for the purpose of this, the main kind of authorship that's probably important is that I co-authored Pragmatic Unit Testing in C#. And even though it says C# on it, everything that is in there is relevant to C++, 100%. Also, I am unemployed right now and looking for a consulting gig, so if you like what you hear, I can come into your office and tap dance or whatever. I'm an indie musician, and that's my Bandcamp page there. It would be neat if people went and listened to my music that I work so hard on. Here's my opening kind of gambit here. The only reason to do unit testing is for a sustainable competitive business advantage. And that's not what tech nerds want to hear. I'm a tech nerd, and it took me a while for me to realize that the only way to get practices like this adopted is to approach them from a business perspective. You shouldn't do testing because it's a warm, fuzzy, granola, hippie kind of thing to do, or it's really bohemian, or all the cool kids are doing it, or all those Rails and Node.js kids are like testing like crazy, and I want to try to attract them to my company, therefore I want to say I do testing. The only reason to do this is for sustainable competitive advantage. And as we go through this, I'll be kind of making notes, little comments along those lines. In my experience, real unit testing, and we will talk about the definition of unit testing and the and different kinds of testing that there are, is the most reliable route to an object-oriented, or if you don't like the term object-oriented, we can just say modular. Some people have an allergy to the term object-oriented design, in my experience. I've been working on different software projects professionally for about 15 years, and I lived through UML and saw it do almost nothing on every single project. I lived through a lot of other things that were supposed to try to help design or enforce design and all these other kinds of things. And in my experience, unit testing by developers as they write code is the best way to get there for reasons that will become obvious as we go through. I focus on unit testing here, but unit testing is not to the exclusion of integration testing or system testing. This is not the new altar you should worship at the exclusion of all of the other kind of software practice gods. So that's the kind of pragmatism aspect here. Unit tests can give you a certain kind of feedback at a certain speed, but that is not all of the feedback that you could possibly get from integration tests and system level tests. And we'll talk about that as we go. And getting back to the kind of like sustainable competitive advantage point here, focusing on ease of consumption of tests, the test code themselves, as well as their output, especially when they fail, and the ongoing maintenance of those tests, the kind of friction coefficient that you get by having more code that you have to kind of keep up to date, is key for a return on investment on unit tests. You can, and a lot of companies do start out having a great return on investment for the unit test, and then as their code base scales, as their team scales from 10 developers to 50 developers to 100 to 250 to 500 to 1,000, because they weren't paying as they kind of went, as far as keeping their maintenance costs low with regard to their test code or their implementation code, it starts to not pay for itself, and then the argument you have to try to get people to keep doing it is going to be harder and harder to do, and reasonably so. If it's not paying for itself, why do it? Another thing I'm going to mention here is that there's a lot of C and C++ kind of unit testing frameworks out there. I'm going to focus on one here, and everybody has the pet one they like. A lot of people roll their own because they think that their code base is a unique snowflake in the universe, and therefore no framework could possibly meet the needs of whatever their code base is. But just because you're in C and C++ doesn't mean you can't make fluent syntaxes that are enjoyed by users of unit testing frameworks in other late binding languages, right? And that's really the crux of the problem in C and C++, is the early binding nature of the language as far as trying to get a syntax that is reasonably composable and dynamic and readable. And yeah, actually just those things alone is actually quite tough to do. So without further ado, so I know that in the modern age of presentations, people are on their laptops and tablets a lot. That's totally cool. Just turn your ringers off. So if anybody wants to jump ahead and go look at the code for C-Green, which is a unit testing framework, or Mockito PP, which is a mock framework, so that they have deeper questions at the ready, cocked and loaded, at the end of the talk, you can go to those links there. Also, just doing a web search for C-Green or Mockito PP will take you where you need to go. But I figured I'd put this at the front so that if someone wanted to kick the tires quite deeply, they'd have the opportunity to do so. So agenda. So we're going to talk about what unit testing is and is not. Sadly, every company that I've been at, for the most part, has had a misunderstanding of what unit tests are. Every company I've been at where I'm called in to help a team that hasn't been in trouble or a product line that is in trouble, we already have unit tests. Why are you here? And then you go to look at the code for their tests, and they're not actually unit tests. And this isn't a judgmental or nitpicky kind of thing. It's actually a very important distinction for reasons that we'll talk about on a later slide. We're going to talk about writing unit tests to be read. Some people who make unit testing frameworks, or frameworks period, optimize for a minimum number of characters while writing the code. The code is going to get read a bazillion more times than you had to write it. And so optimizing for short writing is a false economy. Optimizing for readability is key. Also, considering unit tests as documentation is a very good reason to choose a framework that has a fluent kind of syntax. We're talking about mocking, two different kinds of mocking in an early binding language like C and C++, link time mocking and then runtime mocking. Link time mocking is more common. I also have some stuff in there about preprocessor stuff, and I'd mention it for completeness, but I don't recommend doing preprocessor type mocking unless you are, really backed into a corner. And we'll talk about why. And then it's like, okay, great, I can write unit tests and whatever, but I get this giant system, this big ball of mud, it's completely like untangleable, and how would I even get one CPP file separated out from the code base so I could test it in isolation? So we're gonna talk very quickly about breaking dependencies. And a few of the things that I reference in that section are all documented in the Working Effectively with Legacy Codebook, which I have a link to at the end. But if you have to add unit tests to a legacy codebase, that book is a good starting cheat sheet. And I'm pretty sure they had it at the book table outside. Pretty sure. And then we're going to talk about performance. There's different aspects of performance. There's runtime performance, and then there's organizational kind of engineering throughput performance as far as people getting things done, how quickly people can solve bugs, etc. So let's get going. So what unit testing is. So this is worth mentioning because this is one of those concepts that seems to have gotten fuzzier over time. And I didn't make up this definition. If I actually made up the definition for unit testing, I'd be on a beach somewhere drinking tequila and with a pirate chest full of doubloons or something. From Wikipedia, or if you want to go to Mythical Man Month or whatever, it's been the same since. This definition has not really changed, except in some people's minds. A method by which individual units of source code are tested to determine if they are fit for use. The real key here is what is underlined, which is individual units or modules or whatever you want to, whatever 1960s or 70s term you would want to use, to see if they are fit for use. And fitness is relative to what you think it should do or should not do. Modularity is a requirement for unit level tests. And again, like I said at the front, I'm not saying you should only unit test and not never integration test. They both have advantages and disadvantages, and they cover each other's blind spots, so you ideally want to do both. Just want to make that super clear. So what's modularity? So modularity is the degree to which a system's components may be separated and recombined. It's actually a very nice, succinct kind of definition. When you've ever worked with nice object-oriented code bases with clean interfaces and all that stuff, it's like, yeah, that's exactly what it's like. It's like, I take this, and I plug them together, and it just goes. Another aspect of modularity is separating the interface from the implementation, right? And this is something that's kind of interesting about C and C++ is that it's both an interface definition language as well as like an implementation language in one. And you can get in trouble if you conflate those two things too much. We'll talk about that. Unit testing is also testing the things that could possibly break, right? And this is something that we talked about in the Pragmatic Unit Testing in C# book. It's like, where do I start testing? Where do I stop testing? A good example of where to start is what has broken in the past. Where do you start is what was the last defect you had that made it out to the field and a customer reported? Because whatever that was got past all of your existing safety nets, whatever those might be. Or if you had none, then then unit testing might be a good place to start. But also, when dealing with kind of root cause analysis on field reported defects, sometimes unit testing isn't the best tool or the best practice to use. Sometimes, like, oh, that bug could have been found with static analysis. If only Clang Analyze didn't have this bug, and then you file a bug, and then you pay a vendor to like go get it fixed. So sometimes for that kind of like feedback loop of field reported defects, static analysis might be the thing. But if it's pure logic, it's application specific logic, the only way to do it would have been for a developer to kind of like go through and like test different scenarios at the class level, or even at the integration level for that matter. Those are the best places to start. Otherwise, it can be very difficult and unwieldy to figure out where you start testing in a code base. But also, if you're trying to introduce this practice into a legacy code base or a legacy organization, starting with problems that people can't deny is a good way to kind of accelerate the adoption, because you have demonstrable ROI for like, this got past all of our safety nets, we need a new safety net. We're going to introduce this safety net, and we're going to make it so it would have caught this bug. Another thing about unit testing, it is fast feedback that you can get while coding. And I'm just going to have my notes down here because the projector doesn't work. Right. So what does while coding mean? So it means that you're making new tests and running existing tests isn't a separate phase, right? When you talk to a lot of people in legacy organizations, they talk, we're doing waterfall. Well, nobody really does waterfall. When you go read like the NATO white paper where the waterfall term was coined, right? First of all, the paper was documenting a thing that said never develop software this way. But also, those were very, very strict phase gates. And no one has that strict of a phase gate anymore, right? It used to be that the testing phase gate or the quality assurance phase gate wasn't to find bugs to be fixed. It was to find bugs so they could be documented because the coding phase was finished and there was no going back. And that's not the way anybody codes. So when people say we do waterfall, they don't quite know what that word means. You keep using that word, but I don't think it means what you think it means. Unit testing, or just developer testing in general, something you're doing like while you're coding, you are still staying in code. And the frameworks I'm talking about today are both in C and C++. There's no code generators or going through some weird scripting language or anything like that. And so you're still in your IDE and you're just like alternating between your test file and your implementation file. And that is awesome. It's a super tight loop to make sure that as you're implementing things, you're always moving forward and never moving backwards. And that can be very empowering and very morale boosting, as Peter was saying in his talk and for this one. What unit testing is not? So producing a test binary that can only run in a special environment. Right, when we talk about unit testing, we're talking about tests that run inside of the developer environment. If I'm on a Linux desktop and that's my development environment, then that is where the tests run. So an example of this is that if you have to upload a unit test binary to a custom piece of hardware over a 9600 BPS broken UART, and that takes 10 minutes. It doesn't matter how fast the compiler or the tests run. The fact that your deploy takes that long still like makes that end-to-end feedback not very efficient. And again, we're talking about unit tests here. If we were talking about integration tests or system tests, then yeah, you probably would want to run them in the deployed environment. If that's a Super Hitachi 4 CPU, weird embedded microcontroller, or whatever, then yeah, that would be system testing, and that's cool. But here we're talking about unit testing, and those need to run in the developer environment. So if I have a test binary that does run in the developer environment, but it has to link against the entire system because of bad dependency management, the whole system is very tightly coupled, there's no encapsulation, or there's so little encapsulation that everything has concrete references to everything else, and you just can't extricate it apart, that's not unit testing. If you have to link the whole thing in, if you have to link together a 100 megabyte C++ shared library to write a test for a 10-line function, that doesn't quite work out. Mainly because C++ link times can be very, very slow. If you went to the talk I did on Monday about build acceleration, you can do some tricks to speed your link up quite a bit. But a lot of the time, in order to unit test things, we actually have to improve the modularity of the design. And I'll talk concretely about that in the slides later. Unit testing is not an excuse to treat test code quality differently than you would your implementation code. This is probably one of the biggest problems that I see when I go into companies that want to do the right thing. They want to write tests. They're doing the best job they can. It's hard to transliterate some of the literature from Ruby or Java or JavaScript into C++. Again, late binding, early binding, right? There are facets and kind of unique problems and nuances that make unit testing in C and C++ different enough in some ways that you can't just take that existing literature 100%. Those teams where they want to do a good job, they start to write tests, they have tests. The biggest problem that I see in almost every code base with teams like that, crazy amounts of duplication that would never be tolerated in the implementation code. Just straight up copy paste, copy paste, copy paste, copy paste. And of course, just like in implementation code, when you copy paste, you are very tightly coupled to some implementation detail. The implementation changes, the interface changes, you have to go and change all that stuff. And if you're great with regular expressions in Vim, or you have a refactoring C++ IDE, then you can optimize aspects of that, but it's still not great. So unit testing is not an excuse to treat test code quality differently. If you have code metrics like complexity and duplication on your implementation code, your unit test code, and actually your unit test framework itself should comply with all of those same metrics that you apply to your implementation code. Unit testing is not an excuse to roll your own framework. You're like, I got this. I can write macros that do whatever, just like C unit or CPP unit or whatever, and I'm going to feel smart. Because I believe in unit testing so much in this company, I really want to roll my own library. Just don't do it. I mean, really seriously. Like, I'd love to hear, and I have heard many arguments across many companies from many engineers saying, here's why we have to do this special thing. I think at this point in time, 10 years ago, I could have bought it kinda, because there wasn't any mature unit testing frameworks to use, but at this point, there are plenty, and I'll be showing one today as part of the examples. Unit testing is also not an academic distraction of exhaustively exercising all inputs. I talked about in the previous slide, anything that could possibly break. If I have a three line, if I have a getter and a setter method, it's not gonna break. I don't need to unit test all my getters and setters. It's just not gonna break, right? So it's very, very unlikely to break. And you have a limited amount of time, and if you're trying to have a good return on investment where your unit tests catch regressions and help mistake-proof defects that have already happened, then doing this weird thing where it's like, oh, it takes four int params, therefore I'm going to have loops that test, you know, negative max int to positive max int on all of those things, and that is not very useful in my experience. What I will say, though, is that when you have graph traversal algorithms, if you've seen graph stuff, if you are doing rendering engines and all those kinds of things, or if you're doing any kind of like shortest path first kind of algorithms and things like that, then yes, sometimes in your tests you do end up doing what are called kind of data-driven tests where, yeah, you try to make like a bunch of really complex paths to screw up your algorithm, either to get it to infinite loop or to take way too much time. But as far as like straight up values, like ints and stuff like that, and exhausting the entire input space, that's not what I'm talking about here. Tips on how to approach that kind of stuff is in the pragmatic unit testing in C# book. We had some pithy acronyms like BICEP and ATRIP and stuff to describe good tests and how to test parameters and stuff. This should be animated, but I'm afraid to hit play again because it's going to change the resolution, and I'd rather get through the talk. This is the kind of way to think about unit tests. So we have a class K, and I have a test for it, which is a little test module there. And class K depends on these collaborators, C1, C2, C3, C4, and C5. You could think about those collaborators as the call graph beyond class K. Collaborators is a better term to use, I think. So when we are doing system level testing, we are bringing the whole system along for the ride, right? And that's totally fine, because that will tell you certain things that you wouldn't get from narrower scopes of testing. However, system testing tends to be slower, right? Because you are actually doing everything in the system from the front-end user interface, whatever that is, whether it's a socket or an actual GUI or a text input or a REST API or whatever, all the way down to the database or whatever persistent storage you have or the GPU or the whatever. And system tests can be kind of finicky to set up, right? The environment is actually can be quite complex. Automating system tests, having your developers automate system tests is really cool because it really forces you to figure out how to make reproducible deployment environments and forces you to automate that and commoditize that up front. Sadly, noteworthy that I have to say, that is something everybody should do. You know, whether you use Chef or Puppet or Docker or LXCs or whatever it is you want to use, or VMs or whatever, you should figure that out. And system tests will make you do that. Integration level tests are when we don't bring the whole system along for the ride, and my animation would have shown, what we end up doing is we kind of cut off these collaborators, these non-trivial collaborators, and we stub them out. And I'll talk about that in more technical detail in a moment. But using link time substitution or runtime substitution, I make a new subclass called, you know, like the null object pattern. So I, instead of having a Oracle database connector, I make a new derived class from database connector called null database connector that just stubs out and does nothing and connects to no database, right? At the system level and the integration level, real I/O can still happen. Like, these things can do socket related stuff, database related stuff. Of course, the more kind of IO-based interactions like that you have, the flakier the tests tend to be, right? It's like if each one of these tests has to listen on a socket and I want to parallelize them, I might run out of ephemeral ports, right? Or I might have to run it as root, or I might have to, like, whatever. So while the kind of feedback we can get from system and integration testing, right, it's the real system, all the pieces interacting together, and that better represents the actual, what actually gets deployed, since I don't have my thing over here, I need to keep an eye on the time myself. They can be more complex or more difficult to make run consistently. And by consistently, I mean if with the same source checkout, I run the integration test 100 times, the result should be the same all 100 times, including the runtime of about how long it takes for those integration tests to complete. So at the unit level, what we do is all of the non-trivial collaborators, and by non-trivial, I mean we're not going to stub out STL string. We're not going to stub out Boost, right? There's these things that are intrinsics to the language or to the frameworks that we're using. We're not going to mock those out, right? In the C# book, we talk about, you know, we're not going to mock out array list or something like that. It doesn't make sense. It's going to work. It's unlikely to break, right? By non-trivial collaborators, I'll talk about it briefly, but the books I recommend will go through this. Anything IO-based, socket-based, file-based, anything-based, anything that hits a real piece of hardware, if you have an ASIC or like a KVM card for your GZIP or crypto acceleration or whatever, all that stuff needs to get stubbed out for a unit-level test. Why? It needs to run anywhere the developer can compile and run code. And if you want to have a continuous build server and have that kind of grow elastically to deal with like the demand of parallel builds, if you think you're going to put a $50,000 KVM card into every Jenkins server you have, give me some money, because you have a lot to spend, obviously. So at the unit level, we're kind of like cutting off the stubbing out, mocking out the kind of these kind of like first order non-trivial collaborators. And that is the difference. I think it's better with the animation, but I'll take what I can get. So unit tests are actually any kind of developer tests. The economy we're really going for here is optimizing for readability, and I talked about this at the top of the talk, and that the tests are going to be read a lot more than they're going to be written. If they fail and it requires a debugger, then they're going to be debugged more times than they were ever written as well. And this is where choosing a framework that makes debugging also easy to do is key. This is very Western-centric, but when like trying to choose these frameworks, or if you insist on making one of your own, favoring a fluent syntax that reads left to right, it's feasible to do this without going macro crazy. It is absolutely feasible. The other thing, as far as not just the test code, but when they run, passing tests should have basically no output other than like maybe a little dot showing like that it's not hung or something. It's like there's a little dot for each test. If you have tests that just have shit tons of console output, A, that slows everything down, right? If you have a test that would otherwise be running in like a nanosecond because it's super fast and super focused, once there's console output involved, all the buffering and everything else can slow that stuff down by orders of magnitude. And you go, well, if it runs in a nanosecond, then that makes it a millisecond, and who cares? It's like, well, it's kind of the death by a thousand cuts thing, right? Where it's like, as you get to, you know, 100 tests and 1,000 tests and 5,000 tests, as your code base grows, as your organization grows, as you get different product lines, each one of those tests being 10 times slower all of a sudden adds up to minutes. And that can still sound really fast, but it's not fast enough for people to be running the test all the time as they code, right? If I can get feedback by running tests every 5 seconds, like, then I'm just going to keep running the tests. Every 5 lines, run the test. Every 5 lines, run the test. Why? Because why not? Why not have the feedback if it's easy and cheap? And so making things fast is important, and avoiding console output is a big piece of that. Console output is just another like piece of I/O. Even though it doesn't involve the tests and it doesn't necessarily taint the environment the tests are running in, it still slows things down. Also, it's just noise. It's like in the 90s when like nobody trusted compiler warnings, so you go to compile and it'd just be this giant like list of compiler warnings. And you go like, can we clean some of this up? Oh, the compiler false positives all the time. And then of course, everyone had this experience. You'd actually go either have a bug get reported that was real, or you'd just be tediously go through it, and of course some of them were real. And so when your unit tests have a ton of console output and debug logging output and all this other kind of stuff, no one's looking because it's just going by, unless they're like Rain Man or have others kind of like autism spectrum savant capabilities. And we're talking about programmers here, so that's actually not highly improbable. To be fair, I'm not making fun of people's savant capabilities. I want savant capabilities. I'd love to be able to look at the matchsticks on the floor and know how many it is. So passing tests should have very little output. And the passing tests should val grind, hell grind, and call grind cleanly. I mentioned call grind here. One of the things I did at a couple of different companies that we use call grind, which gives you kind of a simulated cache statistics. We would run algorithmic unit tests for the algorithm-based parts of the of the product to make sure that cache misses didn't go up, for instance, after a change. So it was kind of a performance, but not just runtime performance, but like, you know, when we were simulating a L1 cache of this size and someone made a change and it turns out, oh, well, it ran fine on their development box, but when we actually go to deploy it to this ARM SoC that has that little L1 cache, it's going to bust the L1 cache in a tight loop, and it's going to suck on that platform. So we use call grind to get that feedback, but still in the developer environment. So tests should have very little output when they're passing. When they're actually failing, you do want some output, obviously. And they should val grind and hell grind and call grind cleanly. And by the way, when I say that the test should val grind cleanly, that also means the underlying framework should val grind cleanly. And I think that if you go to try some open source unit testing frameworks, you might find that some of them do not val grind cleanly. And then you're like, WTF, how am I supposed to trust this if it doesn't val grind cleanly? Failing tests should provide really awesome clues about what went wrong. And to be fair, there are ways to write assertions and write tests in some of these frameworks, or in all of them, that might have great capabilities, but you're not using it right. And so making sure that when tests fail, the name of the test is descriptive, a given when then syntax. You've written your assertions in a way that when they fail, it's instructive. So if I was asserting, I was expecting something to be zero, I really want to know what the actual value it got was. Because otherwise, what I have to do is go into the debugger. And once I'm in the debugger, I am context switched out of my nice IDE loop where I'm typing in code, running tests, typing in code, running tests. So as many clues as these frameworks can give you when the tests fail, and part of that is just becoming educated on what good test failure output looks like, and then using the framework in a way that gives you that is really key. And just to repeat this again, ease of reading the test code and the failures being relatively actionable is critical. As I said, when you have 10 tests and then 100 tests and then 1,000 and then 5,000 and 10,000, and you have a development organization that is scaling from 10 people to 50 people to 100 to 200 to 500 to 1,000 to 10,000, these things are really, really important. Otherwise, if they're not readable, they're not maintainable, or if when they fail, they're just impossible to debug, you lose, right? All the work you put into it will actually be for nothing. And that makes me a very sad panda. And it happens quite a bit. And, hopefully this is semi-readable at this low of a resolution. The projector liked 800 by 600, so let's pretend like we're in 1996. We can listen to some Pearl Jam. So readability example. So the unit testing framework I'm going to talk about is C-Green. Here, then I mentioned that at the top, and if anyone has any deep questions about it. So I ran across C-Green. I was doing a contract for a very large networking company whose routers route most of the packets on the internet. And they had a C code base that ran on a BSD-ish operating system. And I knew of C++ frameworks. And when I had worked for this very large web search company that had open sourced their internal unit testing framework, I thought I could use that. But as we know, if you try to compile BSD kernel headers or any other KNRC as C++, the compiler basically prints out a little ASCII middle finger. Like, it's just like, no way, what are you thinking? Never gonna happen. Right, and you're not gonna, by the way, and if you think like, oh, well, I'm gonna be a good open source citizen, I'm gonna submit FreeBSD TCPIP stack changes upstream so that it can compile as C++, then you'll get a human middle finger from the BSD committers and those gatekeepers. I couldn't use C++ frameworks, and the C frameworks had some of the problems that I mentioned earlier, right? Bad test output, noisy output, they didn't val grind cleanly, all this other kind of stuff. And with any open source project, one of my main things is, what's the community like around it? You know, how vibrant is it? But also, if I submit a patch, how hard is it to get it upstream reasonably? And sometimes people want you to jump through hoops for coding standards, and that's all cool, right? It's their project. Some projects are just unapproachable because of weird politics and goodness knows what. I was happy to find C-Green because the guy who created it, Marcus Baker, was part of the kind of London Agile scene. He was around for when they made the syntax for JMOC 2 and stuff. So he had exposure to a lot of languages, a lot of different frameworks, which is cool. And that greatly informed C-Green. And also it had a very clean code base that after a few patches, val grinded cleanly, he was very easy to collaborate with, and hooray. So one of the things about C-Green is that it's cross-language, and some frameworks make this claim, they say you can use it across C and C++, but you go look at the implementation, and it's really they use a crazy fork. It's basically two frameworks, completely different implementations in one, and they act a little bit differently. Not cool. Cross-language is actually very useful, I found, in a lot of the companies I've worked for, where they have kernel mode components, and then their user land is all C++. And therefore, for a given developer, when they work on a feature end-to-end, they might do some kernel work, some user land work, and ping-pong back and forth. And one of the ways to reduce the friction of the testing adoption was to say, one framework. And you can use that same syntax in your C code and your kernel code over here, the kernel mode running in user land, obviously, you're not putting the framework into kernel mode, and the C++ code. And that's a big deal. And it just, it's one of those lowers the barrier to entry, makes all of the kind of test code easy to deal with, makes it so that those teams aren't further siloed from each other. They have a kind of a means of communication via tests. Another thing about C-Green, no code generators, it is pure C and C++. And it does use macros in a few places, and macros violate namespacing, and I'm sorry, but one of the biggest challenges I found when enhancing C-Green beyond what Marcus had initially authored was getting a syntax and an implementation that would compile as C or C++ across different compilers, across different platforms. That was really non-trivial. It was a very interesting challenge, but I think I did a reasonable job. I'll let other people be the judge. The nice thing about C-Green is isolation. C-Green actually forks each test off in its own process. This is fantastic, and here is why. In a legacy code base, there's often mutable global state, and if you're trying to write tests that all run in the same process, even with threading and whatever else, it's not about parallelism. It's about isolation. You are gonna have problems where it's like, okay, well, when these tests run in this order, they pass. When they run in a different order, they don't. when I add a new test, and alphabetically when the runner runs it, it sorts it differently, now all the rest of the tests fail. That only needs to happen a few times before people get totally sour to trying to write tests at all. And so isolation is really key. Of course, forking a process doesn't help you if your tests or your implementations are polluting the file system and other stuff. I mean, you could do containers or cheroots or something crazy. I'm not recommending that. But the important thing is process level isolation. And again, it's not about parallelizing for faster speed. It's about making it safe so that the tests don't screw each other up. But also, if you have a test that crashes, just that test crashes. The rest of the tests just keep going, as opposed to, you know, a cascading problem where one test crashes, so none of the rest run. Then you fix that problem and debug that, and then you go to run all of them again, and then the next one crashes, and you work through it that way. And the other nice thing about Seagreen, very minimal dependencies, which is really cool. And so people have used Seagreen for embedded microcontroller testing, for all kinds of stuff, Windows GUI testing, MFC testing, you name it, everything from top to bottom. Not everybody has open sourced, has open sourced their changes, unfortunately. So anyway, the syntax looks like this. Describe TCP parser, and then before each and after each of the setup and teardown. And unfortunately, because of the limitations of the preprocessor and its inability to recursively expand, you have to put those there even if they're empty. And then we say, ensure TCP parser rejects null stream. We make a TCP parser, and then we assert that parser read parser null is null. Assert that is the assertion syntax. The left-hand side here is our actual value, and then the right-hand side is a constraint that says what we expect. So that's pretty cool. The other thing Seagreen does is that it can auto-discover tests, but without crazy static constructors or other stuff that makes other, like, val grinding and debugging problematic. So when you compile Seagreen tests as a shared object, it actually uses, actually kind of reads through the ELF header to automatically discover the test symbols and then just run them that way because, duh. Why not? We don't need static constructors and weird, crazy C++ stuff to do that. So you say Seagreen runner, and you put the SO, and if it fails, it says TCP parser rejects null stream, expected parser read parser null to be null, but it wasn't. Expected parser count parser to equal zero, expected, it's actually flipped in the output, expected zero, but it actually got one. And you can see here that in the assertion output, it says expected parser read parser null, and what Seagreen has actually done is that it has captured the left-hand side here. As a string, and included that in the output, which is awesome, because when the test fails, when that assertion fails, I don't need to go look at the test code to figure out what function call or whatever it was the one that failed. I know exactly what it is, and that's pretty neat. So that's a readability example. Yes, sir? Yeah, thank you. So let's see. So Seagreen also supplies a mock framework for global functions. Right, Seagreen started out as a C-only unit testing framework, and we kind of like moved it enough into C++ land to work quite well. And can I use my mouse? That's more convenient than me reaching up there. Does that work? Yeah, it works. So let me see if I can make this a little bit bigger. Does that help? Probably not. So that stream read function from the previous test, right? If that's a global function, what I want to do is basically replace it at link time with a mock version. And when I replace something with a mock version, I can return a static value. I can just return null or just throw or just stub it out. What mock frameworks allow you to do is to programmatically specify how you want each call to that stubbed function to act. So here, I put it here in the file, but you wouldn't normally do that. But down here, I say expect stream read, stream underscore read, when input, where input is the name of the parameter that you can see up here, when input is non-null, it will return end of stream, and end of stream is negative one. This is a very powerful concept, because now if you want to get into the nooks and crannies of your error handling, you don't have to pull the Ethernet cable out at the exact right time during a system test. You can actually throw an exception, return a value. You can return success, 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 fail, return fail immediately, and really get very robust error handling in your code that way. And then here's a little example of the output down here. I had this expectation stream read would be called, and when it is called, its input parameter would be non-null. And then this parser next chunk must call that global, right? Next chunk ends up collaborating with this stream read global. When I go to run the test, like if I get more calls than I expected, it says got more calls than expected to stream read. If when I ran the test, if next chunk called that global, but it did pass in null for input, cgreen would have told me that. Very instructive output. And this isn't just about cgreen. You want to use it in a framework, it's totally cool. That framework should give you this kind of output, right? It's not just about writing the test. It's not just about reading the tests. It's not just about when they pass. It's also about when they fail. There's a whole economy here that has to be optimized for, not just one thing. I'm going to talk about this very briefly just because we're running out of time. So mocking at runtime, if one of your APIs takes a function pointer as a parameter, just put amper mocked function, done. It's very straightforward. What about not globals, right? This is a CppCon, we should be talking about C++. For that, there's Mockito PP. What Mockito PP does, and I highly recommend if you're a deep, deep C++ ABI nerd and like template nerd, which is totally cool, no judgment, look at the Mockito PP source code. What Trevor Pounds did is actually quite amazing. What Mockito PP basically gives you is that if you have a pure virtual class, it will create anonymous classes at runtime based on that pure virtual class. So a little example here, I have a struct stream that has a pure virtual that has a read method. Using Mockito, I say mock object stream, mock stream. I then tell it to expect that its read method will get called and that the first parameter should be zero. And when that happens, I want it to return zero. Really cool. No macros in the header files, no weird stuff, no -d testing equals one or anything like that. The thing I think I like the most about this is that it kind of gets you into, as I was saying at the top of the talk, kind of forces you into modularity, right? If I have to extract pure virtual interfaces for all of my non-trivial collaborators, that is just improving the object orientation and decoupling things and making things better encapsulated. Unit testability and object orientation are one and the same, right? All the principles like that help one help the other. Here's the two things side by side. I'm not going to talk about this very much, but neither are better. It's just like, do I have to mock a global or do I have a class that I can scope it to, right? And it's not a matter of should I do one or the other. It's like, what's in your code now? I would suggest getting rid of globals and scoping them to instances and things like that, but you got to do what you got to do, right? If your code is full of globals, cgreen's got you covered. If you've got classes, Mockito's got you covered. Link time mocks have more overhead, right? Because you have to have a mock underscore socket thing that you end up linking in, and you have to keep that in sync with whatever the interface for socket or whatever it is as time goes on. Or the compile will fail. But runtime object composition is powerful, and I don't think I need to tell anybody here this, but it allows you to do runtime feature flags instead of if you want to like slowly deploy beta features but only turn them on certain nodes in your deploy cluster or whatever it is that you do. Runtime composition gives you the ability to runtime feature flags instead of building a whole separate binary on a separate branch with a certain define and all that kind of stuff. And the impacts to QA testability are not different. So breaking dependencies. So we have to break dependencies sometimes to mock and stub collaborators, right? There's some impediments to this. So mocking collaborators, doing unit tests reduces the surface area that we need to read and debug when a test fails, right? When I've mocked out all the collaborators, the place I have to look when it fails is quite small. Again, economy. And I hate to harp on this, and I hope nobody thinks I'm a sellout for harping on this, but this is the only reason to do this stuff is for business benefit. So introducing link and compositional seams increases modularity, which is what I just said earlier. And Having better modularity can make it easier to add features, to do rapid experiments, make little subclasses. I'm going to make a traveling salesman problem solver. I'm going to make a GPU subclass of that, and I'm going to use AMP or whatever it is in that subclass, and I'm going to try doing that. And I can do that easily by making a subclass and then passing it in as a collaborator because we had to test that code, and so the interface already exists. The pure virtual class has already been parameterized into its collaborators, and hooray. So it's pretty cool. Let's see. So breaking dependencies, so compile time. So collaborating functions are defined in a header file, and Peter actually talked about this a little bit, I think. Moving the function body into a source file for link time substitutability is key. Or you can make a mock header file. That's where you basically make a parallel include directory called mock include. I have an example in here of that. So moving the target function or method bodies from header files into source files, make a new file, add it to the build if you need to. That'll help speed up the compile, reduce the transit of includes. There's less stuff going on in headers. There's less preprocessor stuff going on. That's cool. That's a source file that is separate now that can be parallelized as part of the build as opposed to getting recompiled over and over again every time it's included. And also just keeps the interface and the implementation separate. So what about inline functions? So like, well, I have this thing that's in a header file because it gets inlined. Are you sure they're being inlined? When was the last time you looked at the assembly code to make sure that that thing in that header file is actually inlined by the compiler? And the compiler's not inlining it because it sees, like, oh, it's used in loop, and if I inline it, I'm going to bust the cache, and the performance will suck. Therefore, I'm not going to inline it. Even if you have looked at it, have you looked at it since your last compiler upgrade? Does the compiler still inline it? I'm not saying that it doesn't ever, but I've every single time in companies people have made this kind of claim, it turns out that the thing they thought was inlined wasn't. Really, the only way to force something to be inlined is to use like the kind of proprietary kind of compiler attributes like in GCC or Visual C++. The inline keyword actually doesn't do what most people thinks that it does anymore. And if you really care about inlining, you should be using link time optimization. And if you don't know what that is, but you can claim to care about inlining, there's a duality there I can't quite wrap my head around. What about template functions? Those have to be in header files. So there it is. Got these out of order. So sometimes templates are actually implicit interfaces. So here, is that readable? I think so. Here I have a template method that takes, that called parse, that takes a T of reader and it calls reader.read. And then I have these classes. I have K, which has a read, L, which has a read, and M, which has a parallel read. Doesn't quite match what the interface expectation is. I make all of them and I pass them into parse. And the last one, when I try to pass an M, M will give an error. And actually, I tested this earlier today because it used to be not too long ago when you would have that kind of like template expansion error where it didn't quite work out. You know, in GCC especially, you just get this like half page of like less thans and greater thans and, you know, kill me now, I hate my life kind of stuff. There's no need for that to be a template. That's someone who has a hammer and everything is a nail, right? So converting that over to be, here's a readable pure virtual class. I parameterize that explicit type. And then I have these things inherit. And now my objects are actually advertising their capabilities instead of having it be like this kind of like implicit interface in template land. Once I've converted this over this way, I can absolutely move this method body out of that header file. And this is a very short contrived example. I mean, I don't have pages and pages here to like go over it with you guys, but this is a very common pattern. And I'm not against templates and I'm not against metaprogramming, but there's a time and a place for everything. And so you gotta do what you gotta do. And sometimes you can't get rid of the whole template class from the header file, but you can get rid of some of it. And when you get rid of some of it, that allows you to get rid of some includes, use more forward declares, that kind of stuff. And that stuff all helps as well. Can't move the body, mock the header. So third-party header containing a non-trivial collaborating class or function. In your source directory, make dir mock include. Copy your networking.h thing, which is collaborating with some third-party complex thing, into a mock include directory. Gut the mock include copy of that file. and stub and mock only the function body that you actually need, and then put dash I mock include on the front of your unit test compile so that it picks the mocks up, the mock includes up first. This is also a good way if you're afraid to make changes, if you're in a legacy, flaky, brittle code base and you're really afraid to make changes. This kind of stuff, even though the maintenance profile is higher, is a good way to get pinning tests in first, and then you can, once those tests are in place, you can make slightly more aggressive refactoring changes to improve the design, improve testability, and do kind of lower cost kind of things. But there is more maintenance overhead this way. Your copy and include fine, you gotta keep those in sync. And you can try to use code generators and Clang tools and stuff like that to help you, and that helps a little bit, but it's still more expensive than actually just having a good design. A third-party non-modifiable header, called a non-trivial collaborating function, override the non-trivial function by defining a symbol. And it's kind of a duh, right? So I have a non-trivial function. I say dash d non-trivial func equals mock non-trivial func. And then I just supplied mock non-trivial func at link time. But you can't do that for all your test stuff. So having to maintain the defines per test file in the make files is like not awesome. So, but you could do this if you don't want to improve the design or don't want to refactor the code. And that's, if you're afraid to change stuff because there's no tests, it can be a kind of a catch-22 there. So sometimes you start off with this stuff and then very quickly get rid of that and then do the right thing. But you need to get those pinning tests in place first if you don't have any at all. I'm gonna skip this. Static classes, classes that have static methods, that can be really bothersome because they're not runtime substitutable. So take that static class and make it into a singleton class, and then update the callers. And for you Vim regex fans who don't like to use real refactoring tools, there's like a little example there. And here's an example of like what that looks like. And this is actually an example from real code base. They had a statistics class that had literally 60 or 70 fields in it, run one right after another just like this. They had a getter and a private field. Should have been a dictionary. I don't know what was going on. But anyway, to test it, what we did is we took that static class and made the methods instance methods, extracted a pure virtual interface, and then made a singleton instance that returned the base class, the pure interface. And then we were able to do mocks using Mockito. Runtime performance. So some people go like, okay, great. So you told me to introduce virtuals. You told me to move stuff out of header files. My performance is going to go to shit, and it's all your fault. These testability and performance are not mutually exclusive. But also, I would say, prove it with a profiler. I think it'll be slower. Like, at this one company, it was literally a three-month battle of sorts, where it's like, don't put virtuals in that class. It's core to our performance. And they didn't have an automated benchmark at all. So we had to make one. And then once we did, we started putting virtuals in one by one, and nothing happened. Why? Well, the bottlenecks were somewhere else, right? And I'm not saying sometimes it's true, and I'm not saying virtuals are like free of like performance detriment or whatever in all cases. Just prove it with a profiler. And let the performance boogeyman people trot out to try to kibosh developer testing is really lame and really old. And just be fact-based. Don't argue the religion. Don't try to convince people who don't want to test to test. Just rely on facts like profilers. The other thing also is that link time optimization, you can optimize across object file boundaries now. Devirtualization, inlining across virtual function boundaries is been in GCC. I was at a company where we helped fund improvements to devirtualization that got into GCC 4.7. Clang devirtualizes amazingly. It's really depressing because we spent a lot of money funding open source development for GCC, and it has regressed, but Clang has just like nailed it. And we didn't pay them anything. Should have paid them instead, probably. And then profile-guided optimization as well. If you really, really, really care about performance really seriously, these are all things that you already know about. And you already know that these are all things that can ameliorate some of the seams that you put in place to improve the modularity, improve the unit testability. Another thing with runtime performance, having automated tests, integration tests especially, gives you a consistent exercise for profile-guided optimizations. The problem with profile-guided optimizations is to generate the runtime profile, you need a way to consistently exercise the program so that it will get instrumented and generate the same kind of stuff. Automated tests solve this problem. I wouldn't do it with unit tests, but integration tests are a great way to do this. And I wouldn't train a profile-guided optimization with all of your error handling cases. And so this is where it's useful to kind of separate out your test suites a little bit and have your happy path cases and then your error handling cases. The reason that's important is because the error handling cases being cold will mean that it won't try to inline them. It'll put them in a separate section of the ELF binary or what have you. If you're in PE land, that's fine too. All the tests should Valgrind cleanly. I'll just say that one more time. Also, one thing I found out a few years ago, Valgrind tools are kind of slow for these short-lived C-green processes. And I talked to Julian Seward, and he said, well, the thing is that libvex has its own little optimizer for its bytecode, and these things are so short-lived that it's actually taking more time to optimize that bytecode than it is for the thing to run. So if you do Valgrind with dash dash vex IR opt level one, that will speed them up quite a bit. If you want even more speed from Valgrind, profile optimize Valgrind. And anyone who went to my build acceleration talk on Monday is probably laughing right now because I talked about that a lot. But you can do it for Valgrind also, and it's totally worthwhile. That was runtime performance. Talking about engineering performance. And the talk I have on Thursday will get into this stuff a little bit more. But basically, there's performance and then there's performance. Right? It's like, well, that's going to slow the thing down. It's like, well, if you have quality problems and you need unit tests to help you with those quality problems, it doesn't matter if you can peak at 10 gigabit per second transfer rates if the box crashes four times a day. Right? Because the average over the day is not 10 gigabits. It's actually much lower because it goes to zero for 45 seconds while the box reboots. It's like, oh, but we have high availability and whatever. Salespeople love crappy code and networking equipment, especially if you have HA, because then they can sell two for every one, right? It's bad news, it's not good business, and your competitors with slightly better quality, not immaculate quality, but slightly better quality, will just eat your lunch eventually. So engineering performance, onboarding new hires, automated tests help with that, especially with readability, being kept in mind and all that other kind of stuff. Also, if the tests are really fast, put them in a pre-commit hook. Just make it ubiquitous, make it a no-brainer, right? It just happens. And a large internet search company that we did work for almost 10 years ago now did exactly this for their umpteen thousand engineers at the time. And if it's fast, it's cool. And you can put static analysis in the pre-commit hook also, because if it's fast, why not? Existing engineers, fast feedback is one of the most powerful things about unit testing and TDD. Every developer I've worked with who has adopted, not TDD even, just unit testing period, once they don't have it anymore, they become very sad. Because it's like everything feels slower, everything feels like you have to be more cautious because you have no feedback on the change that you're making. So unit tests can make it very cheap to arrange exceptional scenarios. We got some weird crash, the stack trace is kind of weird, I don't get it. If you have unit tests in place, you can start to do experiments where it's like, here's what I think happened. And then you can arrange your collaborators and your mocks to try to induce your theory about what probably happened in the field and then see if it induces a crash or not. Very powerful. And even if you're wrong, you can just cross it off the list because you proved that wasn't the problem. And maybe you don't even delete the test because it's still a good scenario to document as far as test as documentation. Another thing with just existing engineers and having unit tests, collective code ownership. Oh, I can't change that module. I'm afraid I'm going to break something. Well, if they have a relatively complete suite of tests, then you should feel empowered to try to make a change and know if you broke something or not. And just also avoid single points of failure. Tests are documentation. Tests are executable documentation, right? So executable documentation, if the test and the code it's testing drifts apart, the test will start to fail, as opposed to doxygen or any other kind of comment-oriented thing. And so that can help you avoid single points of failure. Some companies, some people like to build little fiefdoms where it's like, it's my module, and I have job security, and whatever. And those are usually the people who have the biggest knee-jerk to tests, because it actually screws up their career strategy a little bit. And also engineering performance. it just sets forth this culture of paying as you go. It's like, we're not going for utopia, we're not going for academia, we're not doing this because it's you know, bohemian or hip or whatever. It's because we want to like pay for this technical debt and this design debt as we go and try to mistake-proof our code as much as we can. So some tips, I'm going to skip past these, other than just be mindful of the total cost of ownership and optimize the whole. Make sure it reads well, it's easy to write, they run quietly, and they are easy to debug when they fail. That if you optimize for any one of those more than the others, you're going to have scalability problems as far as when you add more and more developers to a unit testing process or you add more and more tests. There's some links. Here's three books I would recommend. And there's a ton of other ones, but the reason I like these ones is because they're focused on like real production code stuff. Working effectively with legacy code, Pragmatic Unit Testing in C#, and then Growing Object-Oriented Software, Guided by Tests. And this last one is a Java book. Still great and very relevant to C++ from a product existing code base perspective. So thank you. My next talk is on Thursday at 2 p.m. It's a CTO's Guide to Modern C++, how to scale engineering organizations and stuff like that. Again, totally crass. Check out my music. It's on Spotify and iTunes and Google Play and Amazon MP3 and basically every digital storefront. Tell me what you think. I'm on Twitter as at SYKE. There's my email. And does anybody have any questions? Yes, sir. Microphone.
Do you consider threads trivial or non-trivial entities? Like, and how do you do multi-threaded unit testing?
So, sure, that's a very good question. So the question was basically, how do threads come into play in unit level testing? Well, typically when I launch a thread, I'm passing in a function pointer of some kind that's an entry point that is going to kick off. Unit test the function, it kicks off without the thread. That's at the unit level. At the integration level, launch the threads, because that's what happens in the real system, and that's what's going to give you the hell grind information, race information that you want. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Awesome. Questions? Thank you.